Hello everyone, in today's video we will talk about laboratory diagnosis of gas gangrene. What is gas gangrene? Gas gangrene is rapidly spreading edematous myonecrosis. Rapidly spreading edematous myonecrosis means rapidly spreading muscle necrosis occurring in association with severely crushed wound. The wounds are severely crushed, so the blood supply, oxygen supply are inhibited here, and these severely crushed wound and myonecrosis is contaminated with the pathogenic Clostridia, particularly Clostridia perfringens. This gas gangrene is previously known as malignant edema or the clostridial myonecrosis. The virulence factor of this gas gangrene is alpha toxin and the theta toxin produced by the clostridial species. This clostridial perfringens, C. perfringens, is commensal in large intestine of human being and animal. They are also saprophyte in soil, dust and air. C. perfringens is gram positive bacilli, purple colored bacilli. They are capsulated, non-motile, and they have subterminal bulging spore. They are obligate anaerobe. They don't need oxygen to live and they can die in presence of oxygen. So C. perfringens is gram positive, capsulated, non-motile, subterminal bulging spore, obligate anaerobe. They can die in presence of oxygen. So let's have a look on the laboratory diagnosis of clostridial perfringens, which causes the gas gangrene. So this laboratory diagnosis of clostridial perfringens is only useful for the confirmation of clinical diagnosis and the species identification, because gas gangrene is, clostridial infections are mostly polymicrobial. The first method is specimen collection. In cases of gas gangrene, we will take three useful specimens: necrotic tissue, muscle fragments, exudate from deeper part of wounds. What is exudate? Exudate is the fluid that leaks out from blood vessel. These specimens should be put into RCM broth, Robertson cooked meat broth. It should be transmuted immediately. Why? Because they are obligate anaerobe. The second method is direct smear microscopy. Gram staining provides the clue about which species of Clostridia present, which species of Clostridia is present here. And here the absence of neutrophil in infected tissue is the characteristic feature. I'm sorry for the inconvenience. So the absence of neutrophil in infected tissue is the characteristic feature in gas gangrene direct smear microscopy. We will see Clostridium perfringens, Clostridial septicum and Clostridium novae. Clostridium perfringens will look like thick, stubby, gram-positive bacilli without spore formation. C. septicum will look like citron body, leaf-shaped, irregularly stained with spores. And C. novae are large rod with subterminal spores. Clostridium perfringens don't give spore because they are in their favorable condition. The third method is biochemical test for the identification. In Clostridial perfringens, we are mainly doing these five tests. First is target hemolysis, second Naegeler reaction, third reverse CAMP test, fourth heat tolerance test, and the fifth Stormy-Clot reaction test. These Clostridial perfringens can be further identified by the following property. Culture plate should be incubated anaerobically at 37 degree for 2 days. Let's talk about in detail. First is target hemolysis. Suppose this is the blood agar. and it will show inner narrow zone of complete hemolysis due to theta toxin and outer wider zone of incomplete hemolysis due to alpha toxin. So what is the result in target hemolysis? Inner narrow zone due to complete hemolysis because of theta toxin and wider outer zone because of incomplete hemolysis due to alpha toxin. The second method is Naegeler's reaction. Imagine that on the surface of egg yolk occur or the media containing 20% human serum. So this is the plate with egg yolk agar or the media containing 20% human serum, and this is the Clostridium perfringens, and it will produce the opalescence. What produce? It will produce the opalescence surrounding the streak line. But if we add egg yolk agar with antitoxin, then these Clostridium perfringens will not produce opalescence because this opalescence is inhibited by the egg yolk agar with alpha antitoxin. The third method is reverse CAMP test. Imagine that this is the blood agar and we add the C perfringens here, and perpendicular to it Streptococcus agalacti is streaked, and the presence of enhanced zone of hemolysis arrow shaped pointing toward the C perfringens indicate that the test is positive. I hope this makes sense. Now the fourth method is heat tolerance test. Clostridium perfringens can grow in RCM broth at 45 degrees Celsius for 4 to 6 hours. It is heat tolerant, and this property differentiates it from the other clostridial species. The last method is Stormy Clot reaction. This Clostridium perfringens will ferment the lactose, producing acid and gas formation, and so it will produce Stormy Clot reaction in the litmus milk. Suppose this is a test tube filled with the litmus milk, and Clostridium perfringens will give Stormy Clot reaction with acid and gas production. Now the treatment of gas gangrene in infection of Clostridial perfringens, we are mainly giving four treatment. First is early surgical debridement. It is crucial step in management of gas gangrene. Second is antibiotic. Combination of penicillin and clindamycin is recommended for 10 to 14 days. Third is hyperbaric oxygen. As we know, Clostridium perfringens is obligate anaerobe, so they can kill them. And the last is passive immunization with anti-alpha toxin anti-serum. Thanks for watching.